From the people who brought you Six at Six.
That's a catchy number.
Wow. They are talented.
Number nine, have you ever seen this game or heard of it? It's called Corp Ball, and it's played in 69 countries around the world. It looks like basketball, but there's no dribbling. The game is usually played co-ed, four men and four women on each team, and on defense, a lady has to guard a lady, a man has to guard a man, but you can't snatch the ball from an opponent. You can only intercept the pass or get the ball off of a rebound. There's a 25-second shot clock.
I'm lost already.
And you get 1 point for each goal.
I like this.
I've never heard of
it. It's basketball without a backboard.
Yeah. They really spared no expense with those buckets either, huh?
Yeah.
Okay. Wow. Look at that.
Is this sweeping the nation?
This is for the non-dribblers.
Yeah, it's for non-dribblers. It's a big deal. Listen, I'm seeing more defense than I see in the NBA.
Yeah.
Look at that.
Oh, look at here's
playoffs.
More.
Let's see, look at all those people there.
Look at this. I like this.
Dribbling's overrated anyway.
Yeah, it slows the game down.
Yeah. Look at that. All right.
All right, number eight, here's something to make your summer travel a whole lot easier. It's a suitcase with built-in shelves. It's from a company called Royce and Rocket, which was created by a mother and daughter duo.
Oh,
they were
nice.
Talking about packing and unpacking for trips when they thought of the idea. The first prototype was made using a staple gun and cardboard. And from there, this was born. Now, you pack it like a regular suitcase, and when you get to your destination, you can open the shelves. And you've got a mini closet.
Wow.
It's pricey, around $595.
Oh,
but maybe it's worth a few. You could also book a hotel room with a closet,
yeah.
Which a lot of people do.
Yeah.
It's a pro traveler tip that I like.
It's just unloading all that stuff.
You get a day's in for like $98.
Right. Yeah. Call ahead, make sure they have the closet.
All right, number seven, it's spring, and my social calendar is about to get very full. I'll be attending many garden parties, and I bet you all will be too, so I want to share my favorite app that I like to bring to the party. As an appetizer.
Look
at that, right? It's ladybugs. Now, let me tell you how you do it. It's a slice of fresh mozzarella. Then you put in a little single basil leaf on the top. Then a half of a cherry tomato.
Ooh.
And how do you think I made those adorable little spots on the ladybug?
Balsamic vinegar.
Yep. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's a drizzle of reduced balsamic. You're right, Pat.
And that's an olive for the head? Is that what that is? A sliced olive?
Yes. Yes, that would be correct. A lot of people would compare me to Martha Stewart, but she's, you know. She's garbage in comparison to what I'm doing here.
Look at you. That is very whimsical.
Yeah.
So every time I've had a good Caprese, I've thought, if this was whimsical, I would enjoy it a lot
more. You're
all
right.
All right, number six, you're going to see here a bearded vulture.
Well, that sounds like a euphemism.
Yeah, it does. What?
Let's see.
Oh, there it is.
This guy's going to show us how it's the only animal that feeds almost exclusively on bones.
Oh, my God.
It just swallows it all.
Bone guzzler.
Wow.
Are you kidding? Where did it go?
Wow. It's like a sword swallower.
Well, you know they say the vultures are always, you know, not a good sign if you're laying there injured.
I hope they have a good digestive system because that could be some trouble.
It says their gastric fluids are so strong.
Wow.
That they can easily digest bones. Generally, they will find bones in a carcass, then toss those bones from a great height. Then they'll fly down and eat up all the broken pieces. But this guy ate the bone whole.
Huh.
Look at this again.
There he goes. Oh, boy.
God.
No manners.
Right down the gullet.
Right.
Wow.
Whew. All right, number five. Presidential historian Michael Beschloss tweeted this. It's the contents of Abraham Lincoln's pockets at the moment of his assassination in 1865.
That's cheerful.
These items were shown to the public until 1976, but we're not sure why. Anyway, he was carrying two pairs of spectacles and a lens polisher, a pocket knife, a wash fob, a linen handkerchief, and eight newspaper clippings, including several favorable to himself and his policies. If you're wondering whose likeness is on the $5 bill, that's C.G. Memminger, who was the Secretary of the Treasury, but for the Confederacy. So why the heck was Lincoln carrying Confederate currency? Well, Lincoln had just visited the fallen Confederate capital of Richmond a few weeks earlier, so he probably kept the money as a souvenir. Yeah. And of course, it is Lincoln's face now on our $5 bill.
Wow.
All right, number four, looking back now, releasing 1.5 million balloons seems like it could cause some problems. But back in 1986, when people partied in Cleveland, the local chapter of the United Way thought it would be a harmless way of raising money by breaking a world record.
Oh, my God. Yeah,
it was called Balloon Fest 86.
Oh, great.
Charity hired a guy in L.A. who was a pioneer in doing big things with balloons.
Look at this.
They
this is
planned
awesome.
This for 6 months. They even built a giant holding pen for all the balloons.
My God.
Where local volunteers, mostly high school kids, spent hours filling the balloons with helium. Wow. On the day of the release, was expected. The balloons collided with a front of cool air, and that brought the balloons down into the many waterways around Cleveland.
Geez.
Besides the obvious pollution, the balloons caused traffic problems and car crashes. They spooked livestock and led to an airport shutdown. The fundraiser lost money, but listen, let's not forget the most important part of this. They did set the record.
Yeah.
In the Guinness Book
funds. Oh, jeez.
Yeah. We're still
only
here.
The second worst thing to happen to a lake in Cleveland, though.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, God.
This is unreal.
I've never heard of this. I mean, I remember Hands Across America. Yeah. I don't remember this at all. Maybe they were trying to sweep it under the rug.
Yeah.
They want everybody to know about it.
The video is
unbelievable. And you can't plan that far for the weather? I mean, how long were they filling balloons?
That's not an easy task, filling balloons and tying them. All right, number three, let's talk about coffin bread for a second.
Ugh.
Don't let the name scare you. It's quite a treat. Coffin bread is a retro Taiwanese street food invented back in 1959. It's a chicken liver chowder surrounded by deep-fried toast with the middle carved out, so it looks a little bit like a coffin. The fun part about coffin bread, you can stuff just about anything in there. You put some shrimp in there if you want some tuna fish, turkey, veggies. It's like pot pie minus the pie part.
Mm.
So look at that. Isn't that fun? Mm. A lot of whimsy.
Yeah.
Right there.
Yeah.
You can put anything in there you want. You can put your car keys in there if you want.
Yeah, you could. Yeah. All right, number two, we're looking at songs with completely misunderstood meanings, courtesy of our pals at Mental Floss. Like this one, Total Eclipse of the Heart by Bonnie Tyler.
And you're never coming around.
Turn around.
Every now and then I get a little bit tired of listening to the sound of my tears.
Turn around.
Every now and then I get a little bit nervous that the best of all the years have gone by.
Turn around.
I don't know how long you want me to wait till the chorus.
Yeah, I keep waiting.
And then I see the look in your eyes.
Turn around, bright eyes.
Every now and
anyway.
Oh, yeah.
Did I let enough play?
Yeah.
We may know it as a really big 80s style ballad.
Yeah.
It is, but it's also a vampire love song.
Yeah, it is.
The writer Jim Steinman said the original title was Vampires in Love, and it was meant to be in a show about vampires.
Oh, nice.
Steinman said it's all about the power of darkness and love's place in the dark. Mm. The writer passed away in 2021. Is he the same guy who wrote all those songs that Meatloaf sang, all those big ballads,
yeah.
Terry? Didn't we do a 9 at 9 on him? Did we have that right?
Right.
Yes.
Boy.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. The Vampire's Big Chance, it got changed, and they're still looking for love.
Yeah.
But I'll tell you, could have used him in those Twilight movies, you know? Just to hold on to him for a few more years.
Right.
You got bad hours, so you got to turn that around.
Number one, to prove our theory, we spoke to our resident expert, Greg the Vampire.
Once upon a time, I was falling in love, but now, you know, whatever, it doesn't matter. There's nothing I can do. It's, you know, whatever eclipse of the heart.
Yeah, it's not quite the same.
Original lyrics.
Yeah. Nice to see Greg still rocking the isotoners.
Yes.
Yeah. He says a blog stamp. I thought that he's the one
very
of the most loyal customers.
When you're around blood that much, you got to wear gloves.